Just to some housekeeping, as always, for those of you who have been here before, we're going to have everybody's mics muted, but you are in control of unmuting your mics, so just be cognizant of that if you, by chance, unmute them. When we get to the question and answer session, you'll need to unmute yourself to ask a question. You can always use the chat window, and we'll be glad to address them there as well if you'd rather do it that way. Again, welcome. We're glad that you guys have joined us. So without further ado, Steve, why don't you introduce yourself and get rolling.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Garrett. Appreciate it. This is Steven Crescenti. I want to welcome everybody today to our fourth Polarion Tips and Tricks. I was actually able to kick off the inaugural Tips and Tricks that we did now, 4 weeks now. That was originally, I started with the switch language tip and trick, and I was kind of showing customers how we can actually utilize multiple languages inside of Polarion Live Docs. And as you see here, I'm utilizing Polarion for everything. I'm actually even utilizing Polarion just kind of for an overview. You know, instead of having to go ahead and go to PowerPoint and switch back and forth between different applications, I'm actually using it to kind of show you an itinerary of what we're going to be going through here today. Just to give you a little bit of background about myself, I came originally from the Polarion acquisition. I've been with Siemens now for a total of 5 years. And I've been specializing in the Polarion product suite, as well as working with other groups inside the organization to integrate Polarion into other products for the end-to-end digital thread that we offer here at Siemens. I did both implementation services as well as pre-sales engineering work, so I could actually speak to both sides in terms of services, as well as what we can talk about, bigger pictures, understanding the product and how we can apply this. Now, one of the things that I've seen in the past with working with customers is the Polarion planning piece is sometimes very, very attractive in terms of how it works with customers. It's got a lot of great visuals to it, and there's some great functionality that you could do to it, not to mention ease of use and quickly being able to move elements from one phase to another phase inside of the project itself. And so what I wanted to do is for this little session here today, for the next 20, 30 minutes, just kind of show you a real quick out of the box visibility on this one. This particular project I'm using is the remote library project. I called it the remote library, seeing we're essentially all remote these days. And this is based upon the Polarion e-library project. So it's an Agile-based project, which is used for doing, you know, Agile demonstrations that we have with different customers. And everybody that has a Polarion server should have this e-library project in here. So you can actually reproduce things that I'm doing today and actually get a little bit of better understanding in terms of what you want to do. Additionally, like Gary did mention, if you want a little bit more deep dive, either for some of your particular concerns or some more additional things that we want to do with Polarion planning, we could definitely schedule sessions with either myself or any of the other pre-sales engineers with you directly, and then be able to address any of your concerns that you have. So let me kind of give you for an introduction. So it's going to basically be an overview planning. We're going to talk about the plans and the sub plans, and the words are going to kind of be a little bit fluid in terms of how they're going to work. And we're going to talk about how we're going to manage our work items. And it's essentially going to be a step-by-step approach. So now in terms of nomenclature with the Polarion plans themselves, the overview is related to releases and iterations. And essentially that's how Polarion's calling them out of the box as an element themselves. Now, a release is going to be where work items are implemented in each phase or of the release itself with dates applied to those. The work items are going to have individual tasks associated to that, and they're going to be implemented during what's called an iteration. Now, an iteration is going to be a smaller breakdown. So if you think about it in terms of a release of a product, you may say, I have a quarterly release, and that quarter release has multiple steps or multiple sprints, if we were to start talking about Agile now. Multiple sprints that have to happen to be able to release that release. Now, if you look at my diagram that I drew up here, I changed the verbiage intentionally. So we can have release A, which could be 8 weeks, and then we have iteration 1 through 4. Now, each iteration is going to be 2 weeks in length in order to get it done. Now, if you look over here on the right-hand side, I've got release X, and that's 4 weeks in length. So it's a much shorter release cycle that they have, and each iteration is going to be 1 week in length. But if you notice, the iterations themselves are called sprints. So sprint 1, 2, 3, and 4 using Roman numerals. So you notice that it doesn't have to adhere to particular standards of the product. If these are the naming standards that you use in your organization, this is what we can look for. And then last but not least, I've got say version 4.0. So now it's not even called release, it's now called a version. And this is now 12 weeks. And so each iteration is 4 weeks in length and there's only three. So again, you're not hard to find to a particular process and how you're going to be addressing things. So as I scroll down through here, I'm going to go through the demonstration. I'm going to kind of give you an overview of what I'm going to do first. And then I'm going to leave this first tab up and running so we can jump back and forth and I can show you the different things that we're going to be doing. So, but just to give you a quick overview, we're going to go through some of the steps. We're going to create a release, which is a version, and an iteration, which is a sprint. And then underneath that, we're going to configure the properties for the individual release, right? So we want to say set a capacity, which means how much work can be applied to it. Start and due dates, and then any releases that have to be associated with that particular release plan. And that's another work item that's defined inside the system. Now, as I continue on, we're going to assign the types allowed in the properties for each. So for example, you may have a particular type of release of a product, but maybe there's different types of work items that are associated to that. So again, right now, like for example, in this picture, it says user story epic. It doesn't necessarily have to be that. It could be a requirement. It could be any sort of element that you have. It could have a voice of customer call, it may be. And then last couple of pieces we're going to do is just basically, again, create the release associated to the release work item, which we show inside this image here. And then we're going to add items to the release and iterations themselves. And finally, we give a review the reporting data and definitions of what the definition of done is, and then take actions about that. The nice thing about the Polarion planning functionality is it does allow you to have a short list, an actionable list of things to get done as you move forward. So with that being said, I'm going to switch over to my second tab over here on the top. And then now I've got my remote library, I've got my Polarion landing page, and I'm just going to go to my plans. I'm going to expand out plans. As you notice here, I've got version 1, 1.1, and 1.2. If I click on the plans, section itself or the space itself, it now shows me all the different plans that I have. So all the different versions and all the different iterations underneath that and all in hierarchical phase. But for now, what I'm going to go ahead and do is create a new particular version that we're going to be working with today. So we're going to create a version and it's going to say, what do I want to create for a new plan? It's going to be, do I want to create an iteration or a release? And again, this goes back to the names that I mentioned earlier. So I'm going to say a release. So again, the release is going to be the version, the higher level element that we're looking at. And we're going to call this one version 2.0 because we have 1.2 already defined, right? I don't want to associate a parent with this yet because there is no parent for this. And I'm going to be using this for an iteration. And I'll show you that in a second. So version 2.0, ready to go. I'm going to say create. And it now brings me automatically to my plan and it says the version's not started. To kind of shortcut a few things now, I'm just going to go back to plans and I'm going to create my iteration now. And so we're going to say iteration. And so what we're going to do is we're going to call this sprint I. So for Roman number 1. And then I'm going to associate the parent with it. And now what's going to do is it's going to ask me which particular plan inside the Polarion planning section am I going to be associated to. So I'm going to select version 2 and say create. And as you notice now, when I've created this, now I see this hierarchical level or this relationship defined between sprint Roman number 1 and version 2.0. So now I'm going to code a version 2.0. And we're going to say, okay, we've got elements here. So the first thing that Polarion is going to do is it's going to give me some feedback, right? It's going to say chart needs some input. Please set the start and due date in the properties and add some work items to the plan. So this is kind of giving me just a cheat sheet in terms of how to address this or work with this. So I'm going to go ahead and hit properties. And it now brings me up to version 2.0. Okay, so version 2.0 here. Okay, status is open. I'm the current author of who this is. I'm going to go ahead and say what's going to be our start date. Let's go ahead and start this last Sunday, the 20th. And then our due date, because this is a larger version, we're going to go ahead and maybe set it a little bit further down in the future. And we'll scroll to the very, very end, and we'll go to May of 2020, and let's go ahead and push it to the end of May. It seems like a good time frame. It gives us about 6 weeks to get some work done. And now it's going to ask us for capacity. If you hover over capacity, it's actually going to tell you what to use. So a lot of elements inside a Polarion you may or may not know actually have little kind of help tips on there, little help clouds. And so this is going to say hours or points. Well, how many people am I going to have associated to this? Well, if I've got 6 weeks, for example, say, and that's roughly 40 hours a week, we're looking at 160 hours, 240 hours for a total of 6 weeks. That's for one person though. So, but maybe I'm going to go ahead and say this is going to be a capacity of 480 hours, right? So now we're going to say two people are going to be assigned to this, and this is what we're going to be using for this. Additionally, it's going to say allowed types. I can set this up inside my administration sign or as a default to say, what do I want to use? Currently we're using user story, but I'm going to add in epic to make our lives a little bit easier too here. So we can actually see multiple pieces inside of this. It's going to be time-based. We can also set it by a custom field. So if you wanted to say, I want to leverage a custom field of a priority or a calculation type, let's say if I wanted to do things like in story points, I can actually leverage a custom field for story points on that. But for now, we're just going to stick with time-based. Everybody understands time a lot easier. I don't necessarily know the background of everybody that's attending right now. So time is something everybody can understand. We're going to go ahead and hit save. So now we've got version 2.2. We have everything saved. I actually didn't put a started date started on. So let's go ahead and say, let's start it. Yeah, you know what? No, let's not do that yet. I'm going to go back before I go ahead and start it, because I want to show you one other button that we have to address here. We actually have an open, an in progress, and a done. So just like work items, just like documents inside of Polarion, even the plans have their own workflow or their own statuses associated to it. So I don't want to go ahead and set it in the properties. I want to show it here so at least you can kind of see what's going on. Right now, it's also again giving me another tip. Please add some work items to the plan. Hey, Steve, you need to add some work to it. Okay, so what do I have to do? I can go ahead and say add work items, but additionally, I could also say create a release work item. And let's go ahead and do that. And that was one of the little steps that I showed you on my intro document. So the create release work item is actually related to a specific work item type. So each work item, each release will have its own release work item or version work item. And then we can address some custom fields or custom information to that so we can understand who the owners are and who the people that are associated to that. So what is this one gonna be called? Let's call this one version 2.0. Very, very simple, very easy to work with. Let's go ahead and scroll this up so you can see a little bit more real estate here. And now it's gonna ask me a mandatory field. If you notice, has the red asterisk here, says release plan, which one is it? I'm gonna go ahead and hit the dropdown. You can see that 9.9B is already completed. It's got a strike through on it. But I've got version 2.0. Oh, and look at that one's due on 531. Let's go ahead and associate that. And if we want also right now, we could even assign a QA manager to it or even a PM to it. Let's go ahead and say Robert Project is gonna be my release QA guy. And I'm gonna hit save. Additionally, I could set other information in here like freeze date, code freeze date, or feature freeze date. A particular launch date. So even as your project managers, your product owners, can actually look at this and understand the information that you're putting into this and be able to get it in a one-stop shop location. So let's go back to my plans and I'm gonna go to version 2.0. Right? And it's now telling me that, okay, again, I still need to add items. And if you notice, this little list is actually dropping down to a smaller and smaller list because that checklist was originally there to say start and stop dates. And please associate to a release, it's going to start disappearing because I already have the things taken care of and associated to it. You can also see here that I've got my release item now associated down here, and I could even get reporting information on it too. But let's go ahead and add work items to the plan. And now what it's gonna do is it's gonna look up for user stories and epics, right? So let's go ahead and load them all. And I'm gonna go ahead and pick some user stories and epics. And so let's see, what do we wanna grab here? Let's go and sort them. And we're going to go through some things that may or may not be completed. Let's see, how about 136 here? That's a user story. And then how about maybe 199 books over here? This is an epic that's associated to it. And if you notice, I'm hitting the check boxes on these. And as I'm going here, I can now associate any particular items that I want to add to the list. So I'm going to say add. So I've got 9 things that are planned, and then I've got unplanned is 50 days. So I'm going to go ahead and save. So now I've got version 2.0 ready to go. So now if you open up my plans again, and I can see version 2.0. So again, it still says plan not started, right? Because it wants me to have an action there. So I'm going to go ahead and fire this up and say this is in progress. Are you sure you want to change the status? Yes, by all means. So we're now our project's in status, and it's going to tell me what work has already been done. If you notice, some of the items selected, because this is a demo project, actually has some work that is quote unquote done. So you can actually see already some progress that's been done or completed as part of this. Then you could also see what things are currently going on inside the project itself, like what's in progress, two items. Now, as I scroll down through here, it's going to say, okay, right now I've got no in a target or an epic release plan, I need to set a target version in the custom field itself. So if you notice, I did select an epic, but that particular epic, which was, if I recall correctly, epic 199 or work item 199, it didn't have the target version in there. So what I also need to do is make sure that anybody that's associating these particular epics also know that they have to make sure it's targeted. So the easy way to do that is I'm just going to go to my epics and I'll go find my 199. Right. So target version, well, because this was originally a demo environment, it says version 1.0. We're going to go ahead and change that to 2.0. I'm going to hit save. And then we're going to go back to our plans in version 2.0. Now you'll see the chart has changed a little bit. As I scroll down, right, I now see that I've got targeted epics, and the targeted epics is 199. But if you notice, I've got additional epics inside of here. This additional epic is 198. Now, if you recall correctly, I did not select this basic product behavior, but I did select this item over here, 136. And that item 136, if I were to actually go into this and this one, and I'm going to open this one into a new tab so I can just kind of easily go back to this particular tab. If I look at item number 136 here, and this is a user story now, so this particular user story has a relationship. Its parent object is this 198, is this other epic that's associated to this. And so now you'll notice, as I come back into the planning section, those additional epics will be highlighted because that particular user story was selected. And it's using that traceability to be able to identify the different pieces that are going to be addressed in this version 2.0. So you see the planning functionality has a lot of intelligence to this. And what we're going to be able to do is actually identify more information that we're going to have to address inside there. But this is only two items that we're going to add in here. We're going to add a couple more work items to the plan itself. And so let's go ahead and add a couple more user stories to make life a little bit easier. And let's see if I can find something that was that we can work on here. How about, say, 121 sounds good there. And keep scrolling through some of the user stories, some of the completed. Okay, 205 is already inside there. That's a good one too. We've got system speed. We're gonna add that one more. So save. And now again, we can come back to the plans. And we now see there's a lot more work to be done. So there's 19 days and 2 hours of work to do. Again, I've got targeted epics and now additional epics. Again, I did pull additional epics in there because I selected one of the other items that was added in here. Now, additionally, as I start looking through the plan itself, I also have the ability to drag and drop. So if you notice here, I just grabbed onto this configure contact information, and now I can actually drag and drop this as any process I want. I can say mark this as implemented or stop progress or maybe rework it. And what this is now doing is utilizing the Polarion workflow engine. And that Polarion workflow engine will actually be able to go ahead and say, these are certain things that have to be done in order to move this. So for example, if I were to go ahead and say, reject this one, right? It's now gonna pull up the work item properties. And the work item properties is actually now forcing specific rules and criteria put in place to say certain things have to be done. So for example, resolution has to be completed because it says please fill in required fields. So it's not just going to let me drop it inside of that particular swim lane arbitrarily, but it's going to go ahead and force a path for me to do that. Now, I'm going to ignore, go to sprint letter one, and say discard my changes. So now, just like I did on my version itself, I also have a plan that's not started. So what we have to do is we have to say, what's the capacity of this going to be? So maybe this particular capacity, we're going to say start, first of all, and we're going to say the 20th. And then the due date, we're only going to do it 2 weeks, so we'll say the third is going to be the due date. Let's say this particular sprint is a two-week cycle. And if I recall correctly, we were doing how many hours? We're going to say capacity is going to be 80 hours. Two people, 2 weeks. One person, so 160 hours. So two people, 2 weeks, so 160 hours. Again, this is time-based. This may only be asking for user story. We're going to probably not want to put an epic inside of this sprint. So again, as each hierarchical level I work with, I could define different types of items that could be associated to those particular work items. And again, we'll start this too here. I'm going to hit save. I'm going to go back. Now, if you notice, again, please add some work items to the plan. We're going to start, first of all, go ahead and say, kick this into progress so we can actually start this up. And now we're going to add the work items to the plan. Now, the interesting thing when you add work items to the plan under the sprint view or the actual iteration view is it's now specifically filtering based upon things that are planned in version two. So if you notice, I selected work items to be associated in version two, and it's only going to show me those particular user stories that are going to be available to associate it. So this way, it's going to give your users a lot better user experience and be able to not have to worry about sifting through lots of different work items for this. So for example, we can go ahead and select a couple different work items in here. We're going to say maybe 136 sounds great, and we'll do 205 sounds good also. Okay, and we're going to go ahead and save. Now we can go back to sprint one. So again, here's my burn down chart. Here's my expectation of work that has to be done. And now again, also see my planning board is filled out. I have information associated to it. And yet I still do have the swim lane functionality to go ahead and use that to address it and close out particular pieces or information. But let's say I want to implement this, and we're going to mark this one as verified. We're going to get this one completely done. And resolution, we completed it, so it's done. Okay, and now we even got system speed here. Let's go ahead and go back to now version two. So again, any work that's also done inside of the sprint themselves will also roll up into information into the versions themselves. So now again, we can scroll down through here. We could see additional information that's completed. For example, 105 is resolved, and you also see that who the people are associated to it. So it's got letters associated to the individual names. So you can kind of get a quick identifier for the particular individuals. This one happens to be Steve, developer. You can actually see other information about who's in process here. Okay, we're gonna say okay on that one. And Steve, developer, and Philip Gui, as you see, that's two people associated to this one. That's completely in progress. But we're gonna go ahead and we'll drag this one over and we'll say mark it as implemented. And that's resolution, we'll mark that as done. And we'll close that out. So now, finally, to wrap things up, we're also going to see that there's unplanned issues. So unplanned issues are basically any sort of issues that are not associated to the plan itself. So for example, if a bug or a defect or an issue was found, how do we know that that's going to actually get mitigated in that particular piece? So again, certain things, which versions they occurred in and where they were at. So for example, with this failed favorite books, if I wanted to, I can open up that particular item. right? And then I can also go ahead and again say which particular target versions they may be working for or working towards. And now come back to my plan and do a refresh. So now you'll notice, because I associated with version 2, now this is an issue that's going to be addressed in version number 2. And then last but not least, the one other piece I wanted to talk about, which was kind of almost becomes like your checklist now. So for example, this is now going to show me my progress of what is going on for this particular version 2. So epics that are done and meet acceptance criteria. We have one epic that's targeted for this release, but it's also not verified or rejected. So what does that really mean? Well, how do I identify that? So if I right click here and I say open a new tab, again, this is me using multiple tabs, so I can easily go back and forth between the different panels without having to worry about a refresh. And it shows me that here's my RL199. This is my epic that's associated to here. Well, what was it referring to? It's referring to my status, right? I've got this status of in progress, right? But I'm gonna go ahead and say mark it done and hit save. Oh, it wants a resolution again. So it's gonna prompt me for that and I'll say done. Now, it may be done, but what was the verbiage that it was looking for? It says, epic targeted for release 1, not verified or rejected. If I come back here, that just says it's done. But the workflow we have inside of here is mark verified or mark rejected. So again, it has to associate two particular statuses for the report to work properly. So we're going to close that tab. And now if we go ahead and hit refresh, I've got 100% of my epics are now done and they meet my acceptance criteria, right? All verified or rejected. And as you use this, you could then take this particular list of items that have to be done as definitions of done or definition of done, and then use that to go ahead as your short list and complete out all your tasks. This way, this will essentially do your gap analysis for you. This will find out where your gaps are, where your shortcomings are, what pieces of work still have to be done inside of this. And again, still, test case traceability, that's assured. So we've got 4 user stories planned in the release. 3 are not covered by test cases also. So if you want, you can also then identify which particular user stories don't have a test case associated to it. So this way, you have full coverage and your quality assurance group can actually make sure that they do some testing, they do validation, and there's that full coverage of traceability from the definition all at the very, very high level of your lead all the way down to your implementation pieces. And again, as you see here, work was done, but it wasn't necessarily tested on the lab. So to kind of wrap things up, I'm gonna come back to my original initial slide here. And again, we talked about the different pieces of what an iteration is and what a release is, that it really doesn't matter what the nomenclature that you're using here is. Whether it's a release X or A or version 4.0, or if you want to call it a sprint or an iteration, you can. And then essentially what we did was we went and created a version in the sprint. We configured the properties for those. We actually set the capacity, which is the amount of time that's associated to it, the start and the due dates. We also created a release work item to the release plan itself. So this way we could track additional information like quality assurances or project managers associated to that. And then the final few things we did was assign the types allowed in the properties for each. So for example, if I only want a user story, I can only have a user story in it. Or if I wanted to add an epic like I did in our version that we did, I added a version or added the epic. And then as we created that release, and then we added items to the release iterations themselves. And then as I worked through the swim lanes to complete the different work efforts, you actually saw the completion of the pieces done. And then last but not least, I just showed you some of the definitions of done in terms of how that reporting information can be your gap analysis to be able to go ahead and address where some of your challenges may face and what work still has to be addressed to complete. At that point in time, I'm sorry for going a few minutes over on this one. I want to thank everybody for coming in today.